I'm Vicki Nolan, I'm the Deputy Dean of the School of Drama and Managing Director of the REP, and on behalf of Yale REP and the Yale-China Association, our co-hosts, we are delighted to welcome Professor Huang, who is the Vice President of the Shanghai Theatre Academy in Shanghai. I had the privilege of being there in December. I was invited by Professor Huang to teach a course, and so I think we're going to try and get the technology correct. But anyway, it's a delight to have him here, and he's joined by Lena, who also was my host in Shanghai, and he's going to spend a little bit of time talking to us about the culture of arts in Shanghai and what's happening in China, and we'll have plenty of time for questions. Do you want to, or do you need that technology, or is this going to be fine?
Years ago, but for a city and simple. 1943 is an important year in history, and that's when Shanghai became a port, the modern Shanghai of modern learning. Of Shanghai should be talked about with this port in time as a start. From 1843 to today, it's only 170 years. Shanghai is a young city, but the one doubles its magic and charm. Currently, studies in the city of Shanghai around the world have accumulated many literature. I think there are three stages in terms of timeline and the extension of space. From 1943 to 1949 were the long years of hardship, prosperity, and decline. The complexity of Shanghai was fully shown in this century. A metropolis in the Far East emerged on the banks of Zhuzhou River, an empire carried by the Huangpu River, a joyland for the adventurers and their drive ground. This one, 100 years, built the cultural space of Shanghai. That is still influence Shanghai and especially the international factors of this city. In August 1945, the first British concession was set up. The first British concession was set up. This is the lord of Yan'an Lu East. This red route. Sort of Beijing route East. And the west of the bank in this Shanghai. At first, the site was selected on a dry river bed, north of the Shanghai country. But this was a strategic choice, as it was the crossing of the Huangpu River and the Shuzhou River. The Huangpu River and the Shuzhou River later along the two rivers, the British concession expanded, and the American and the French concessions also came into place. Together, they formed the public concession. Public concession is French concession. Public concession. We can see that since Shanghai opened the port in 1943, the city has been through over a century of modernization process. By the 1900s and the 1930s, Shanghai was already the largest city in the Far East. Philosophy's sector in the bank was known by people as the Wall Street of the Far East, which is perpetuated. It also won the name of Oriental Paris. In terms of the special development of the city, Shuzhou River is a key boundary. For instance, it expression of the British concession crossed the Fudu River to around the east of Tibet Loop and the bank of Fudu River. With simple at the bound, this became the political, economic, and cultural center of British concession. And the latter public concession. Along the French concession, through along this Huaihai route to the west, a living quarter of French style was built with French Romans and fashion. With the American concession, the Shuzhou River was further crossed. Expanding along Sichuan route. This into the unique cultural space and features around the large Sichuan route. Interment videos of different styles and cultural patterns cluster in the large Sichuan route area, and it became a rather unique area in the city, where middle and lower class migrants and intellectuals lived and worked, a space for the ordinary people. Along the Shuzhou River to the west, and along the Bangpu River with Bang at the center. The industrialization of Shanghai played out here for near a century. Many ports, ferry ports, full house and factories are located here. Here not the rise of the modern industrialization of China. There is a clear line of a city's development in the modernization process. Progress of Shanghai is seen in the division of the urban space. Today, you can still see traces of concessions in the past. Life and style has not been changing. Only the city has been renewed and revitalized through times. In terms of cultural consumption, the concession center area has larger culture and entertainment for facilities that are very international. In the center, there are skyscrapers, expensive hotels, villas, and apartments, together forming unique urban architecture space. This is the area where the richest work and live, similar to today's Huanghu, Jing'an, Xuhui, and Changning district and liable. This area in Shanghai is still the most Shanghai of all, also the most international part of the city. From 1949 to 1979, when China started reform and opening up, Shanghai had turned from an international metro place into an industry and commercial city. In a way, the culture of Shanghai was repressed. For 30 years, cultural space in Shanghai was rather stable. The socialist planned economy had its corresponding cultural space of the ideology. Topical are the city palace. City palace. East palace. East Palace and West Palace. There is also a large number of culture for cities from before 1949 that changed their function. The biggest feature of cultural change is that Shanghai grew with the new form of socialist culture from a city that measured the Chinese and the Western culture. Western culture was suppressed for a long time. For example, many Western dramas were no longer on the show. Their previous relief culture was replaced by public culture and the culture formed in the concession prayer moved for overseas along with the maker. In any region. From the 1980s to present, the stable situation since 1949 was broken. With the fast pace of reform and opening up, Western cultures rushed into the city, particularly many Hong Kong and the Taiwan team and the field, they militated the city. The cultural spread of the 1930s and the 1940s in Shanghai re-emerged into nostalgia. To a certain extent, it is still in flourishing place. Fashion in Shanghai. The strong nostalgia loomed over Shanghai and became an atmosphere or style. Even symbol of Shanghai, visitors from China and abroad, especially those well educated, favor the old Shanghai more than the rapidly developing city itself. Why? I think there are several reasons. First, after 1949, especially since the 1950s, the strong nationalism and the class struggle ideology deconstructed the old Shanghai culture, but after 1980s, the conflict between the new China and the old Shanghai has been diminished, making that it possible to reconstruct the old Shanghai. Secondly, after 1949, Shanghai's culture, including materials and consumers, were played down and disappeared. But the market economy in the 1980s made it possible for Shanghai to return to that culture. Therefore, it is natural for a city to return to its culture in the old days, crucial span of 30 years. Certainly, the reason is the history, culture, and architecture of Shanghai. Very interesting. When we talk about Shanghai, we are still interested in the several areas in the old Shanghai. All the concessions of Shanghai are still pleased place of the most interesting. After 1949, stories of Shanghai have been told by the many Chinese who migrated to Hong Kong, Taiwan, and other countries. These stories came back to the city in the form of culture, works, and influenced people's ideas about the city. There was a gap of 30 years from 1949 to the 1980s. The strong sense of nostalgia penetrates the profound and comprehensive thinking of people for the cultural structure of the city. Of course, that nostalgia is still present among Chinese overseas and in China. The reasons have not been researched, but the 30 years of separation and the periods of immigration and the deformation of it all are all topics worth our study. After 1949, the city's development had been in totally different style. In a word, the style of the old Shanghai disappeared and everything was singular and similar. The city's space expanded with lots of demolitions and new buildings. The history in Shanghai became ambiguous. The major fear of Shanghai's over construction is to neglect distinction between the old and the new parts of the city in the second modernization process. This is what many of us scholars criticize. These constructions greatly constructed the innate cultural features and the major issues of Shanghai. I agree with Carvey in his scene on modern cities. He says that the similar city buildings and buildings, windows, make the city themselves disappear. The cultural space of old Shanghai was around the concessions. The development of the urban space of Shanghai cruised the Fudu River, mainly because it was developed along the concessions. This is the first big growth in Shanghai's cultural space. Many of the national metropolises have a famous river or cruise that the river witnesses the new and the die of the city. We have Hudson River in New York, the Seine in Paris, the Thames in London, and the Lawrence in Montreal. Shanghai has two rivers that make the heritage of this dreamlike city. They are Shudu River and the Huangpu River. They are closely connected with the life of Shanghai. After reform and opening up, Shanghai was still under the shadows of the concession culture. Centers of the concessions, the Huangpu, Jing'an, Xuhui, and the Changning district area remained to be the elite areas of Shanghai. Industry areas formed after the Yale-China, including North Sichuan Group, declined and had to seek transformation and new life. Putuo and Hongqiao district had new culture belt due to geographic advantage under the new smart grids. Yangpu District was also successful with its universities and the Wujiaochang Suburb Center. Generally, we can see before the 1990s, Shanghai was centralized around Suzhou River, which is still the central line of Shanghai's urban development. However, administratively, Huangpu River had already become the center of Shanghai, but the urbanization of Pudong was slow, and the previous layout of the city remained. Puxi became center of Shanghai's development, and Pudong remained to be explored. East bank of the Huangpu River was still sleepy. In 1992, Pudong development and opening started. Bridges and tunnels were built, and eventually, Lujiazui became an important and banned area. This rushed the old city layout of urbanization in the west and the countryside. From land in the west, with the two banks of Huangpu River becoming the new center of Shanghai. The development of Pudong is a complicated and progressive process. However, overall speaking, Huangpu River is of crucial status. Huangpu River offers the port for Shanghai. After reform and opening up, Shanghai came to the globalization stage. Along with the increasing size of ships and containers shipping, Huangpu River can no longer be the leads of modern navigation industries. The relocation of the river port became necessary for industry development in later last century. The Waigaoqiao port was built and production shifted from Huangpu River to the Yangtze River estuary. In turn, the 21st century, the Yangshan Deep Water Port is taking the port farther towards the sea. Huangpu River's function in shipping navigation is weakened. This is the driver for function and the industry adjustment of the Huangpu River banks. Since the opening of the port in Shanghai, most river sites of the Huangpu River were occupied by factory, warehouse, and ports. Very few public space were left for the public. Statistics have led into songs when total area of industry were housed along Huangpu River for over 2,000 and 500 acres, counting 37.5% of top land are used. This enterprise took a large amount of land and embankment of the Huangpu River, dividing the city from the river. Severely impacting the city's dynamics and quality. In the new century, with new round of development, city. Functions of the banks of Bangu River were reformed to drive the coordinated development of socialist economy, culture, and environment of central Shanghai. And it was a necessary choice for Shanghai to achieve its goal of four centers and an international cultural metropolis. Shanghai World Expo was held in the banks of Fangfu River between Nanpu Bridge and Lupu Bridge. Lupu Bridge. One can easily see the reasons behind this decision from historical Shanghai. This is the area that witnesses the industrialization development with remains of the older industries, a center of modification of older town of the city, and the question of how to creatively protect historic and cultural heritages, how to release the culture symbols from deep in history, and how to integrate modern factors in the historical remains have been well answered in the planning of World Expo videos. And we had access to international expensive. The most important is the use of World Expo videos. Shanghai made a major choice to use them for cultural facilities. Historically, the major cultural facilities were around the People's Square in Puxi, but with the World Expo, China as Palace. Shanghai Modern Arts Museum, Shanghai Children's Art Theatre, Shanghai World Expo Museum, Shanghai World Expo Performance Center, and other big culture for cities are shown on the bank of Bangu River. The World Expo Park repatriated roots to become the new cultural center of Shanghai, with the largest exhibition center, the largest performance center, and the largest conference center. The World Expo in Shanghai marked the second leap forward of the Shanghai city development. This is the first cruise of the Fangfu River and the major cultural connection. It marked the shift of position of Shanghai's cultural space along the rivers expanding outwards. This achieved the cultural presentation of the economic deep for the since 1992. A cruise of the river that had not stopped since the World Expo, extending from the southern end of the Nanpu Bridge, the riverside part of Xuhui was already ambitious when World Expo was only in the planning, as it wanted to become the West Bank. Of Shanghai. This is also the remains of the industrial civilization through the projects a dreamer center of Shanghai would arrive here. also recently the Pudong new instructor decided that there will be a Huangpu River site 9-10 kilometers between Nanpu Bridge and the Yangpu Bridge, east of Lujiazui. This is the concept of cultural riverside. On the other side of the river, along the north bank of Huangpu River in the American Concession areas, there is the largest industry belt best preserved in the world, the Yangpu Riverside. This will become another key area of development in the future, from the world export windows towards south and north. The river sites of Huangpu River have become a fresh soil for culture, continually promoting the transformation and the development of this metropolis of the Far East. For these reasons, we think Shanghai completed its second leap forward in cultural space production between 1992, opening of Pudong to 2020, the World Expo. Time has come from Suzhou River to Huangpu River. The two rivers of Shanghai and the Bang perfectly connect these two together. But with the development of Pudong and particularly development for the 2020 World Expo, position and attraction of Huangpu River are becoming more apparent. We can compare the two. If Suzhou River is historic, Huangpu River is modern. The form ones with details and the latter has a magnificence. The form has contact and the latter is open. The form this present local culture and the latter is international. It may not be operating, but it shows some clear views on the difference in cultural characteristics of the two. Therefore, Disney chose Pudong for the history and the culture. Because of Pudong, Puxi has become history, memory, and symbol, and we should cherish it even more. Since the port opened for 170 years, along the rivers we have achieved to leap forward economically and culturally. The World Expo is also a cultural link that will bring great improvement along the Huangpu River embankment. After the Shanghai World Expo, culture structure became more important. A large number of cultural facilities and major projects were on the way to make Shanghai an international cultural metropolis. We have more and more museums, galleries, and libraries. We have the theater, including the Shanghai Grand Theater. There is also a cluster area of drama art. Its history, scale, and difficulties are very similar to that in Broadway and West End. In 2014, there were 30 helping sovereigns' performance and around 8 million audrons, making around 1.4 billion yuan box office. In fact, Shanghai had already become the third theater center, following Broadway and West End. Meanwhile, Shanghai had also the largest culture market in China. Important performances of other places, including Hong Kong and Taiwan, must be on the Shanghai stage, just like the first half of the last century. Shanghai is also an important center of exchange of Western culture, a center for performance of the important symphonic orchestra around the world. We are seeing more and more music, opera, drama, and dance. We also have very active public culture with two songs and three community cultural centers supported by the government. People are more and more aware of participation in cultural activities. So overall, Shanghai is behind New York, London, and Paris. It doesn't have many landmark buildings or cultural brands. Also, the government doesn't invest in culture as much. Our range performance ticket in Shanghai is about the same level as that in New York and London. Certainly, there is a lack of diversity of culture. This means that in the modernization development of Shanghai, an important topic to discover the local and the cultural features of Shanghai. Though we are focusing on cultural development in world cities, I hope that in the near future, we will become one of the important cultural centers of the world. Thanks.
Professor Huang, I have one question. So while you were giving your presentation, I was thinking about everything that you were saying, and I want to thank you first for giving us kind of a historical overview of the cultural development of Shanghai and all the history and the geography that is associated with it. I just have a question that's been haunting me for the last 10 years. And the question is kind of based on one of your hopes that you articulated in your conclusion, that Shanghai join London, Paris, and New York as a major cultural city in the world. And I'm not an expert in city development by any stretch of the imagination, but it appears that for me, what makes those cities most interesting is because of the culture that originated from within. They were looking at, I guess I'm thinking of Paris when I'm thinking of this idea with the coffee centers. That these centers are developed for the people of Paris, and when other people come visit, they enjoy that environment and they stay and they appreciate the culture. So the question that was the kind of the background to the question. The actual question is, then shouldn't Shanghai look inwards at its own culture to expand? Because what I feel that, when I've been to Shanghai, I feel that Shanghai is kind of modernizing and consumerizing, but it's focusing on a lot of Western ideals and Western things. And when I go to Shanghai, and I've been to New York, I'm not particularly drawn to Shanghai because New York already exists.
So let Lena see. So
this is a person from Shanxi.
Okay, we are dealing here with some serious issues.
So my question is, What aspects of Shanghai, of old Shanghai, can be incorporated into new Shanghai so that it has its own cultural flair, that it has its own individual feel that makes it kind of an international metropolis? That's my question.
That's a challenging question for me. Okay, so I think
上海是一个跟纽约看起来差不多像文化的一个就是流行文化和上海如何将自己的传统的文化内涵与这种西方文化融合在国际化的城市中。你们说太多了，我用中文简单就是说，其实我觉得很多时候像纽约巴黎他们这个文化是来自内涵，就是他们自己国民的这些自己的一些因素。
我觉得现在上海没有那些没有表现出那种元素，就是上海和纽约的感觉完全就是感觉是一致的。那怎么让上海把它的旧文化暂时在新的这个社会当中？说的，就是你这是就是你这个观点我完全赞同，因为我在上海也是主要是研究，其实我主要是研究上海的文化，从市场性的文化到政府支持的一些民间的。 民间的公共文化，包括基层的，包括上海郊区的这些文化，
Actually, Professor Huang's expertise is studying, researching on the culture of Shanghai. What he researching is about the for-profit parts and also the government subsidized the public arts. And also, he did a lot of research project to the countryside the culture. So that's what his expertise is.
我自己有一个观点，就是国际大都市可能它的文化发展会有两种类型，两种类型。有两种类型。我比如说，我觉得上海、纽约和伦敦可能属于一种类型，就是他们无一例外的这个国际化，就是它作为移民城市，它的国际化程度非常高。 就是你有时候很难判断它的文化的特点，像柏林、像巴黎，它可能是另外一种文化的发展模式，它非常注重自己本土的国家的传统的文化。
Professor Huang, for the major cities right now in the world, typically they developed two types of the culture features. One, the features like New York, London, and Shanghai, because it's metropolitan immigrant cities, so you can't really tell what the original their original culture is, because in New York there's everything in like from people from China, from Italy, so that's Shanghai is similar to New York in this way.
但是上海和纽约他们又伦敦又有一些不同，比如我们目前也遇到一些困难，比如说上海现在最为人们最喜欢的或者市场占有价值最高的一些文化类型。 从话剧、歌剧到交响乐到音乐剧，无一例外都是西方传过的一些艺术形式。但是我们本土的地方性的一些文化，它很难在市场上有很大的影响力。Also,
currently in the culture market in Shanghai, now the most popular culture is Western pop culture, like musicals, like the symphony orchestra come to Shanghai. If they present in Shanghai, it's easy to sell tickets. But like the traditional Chinese art, like Beijing opera, Shanghai opera, those kind of traditional art forms, it's very difficult to sell the ticket.
所以我们的政府和学者和文化人都是在这种全球化的这种大趋势下，在想办法来保护一点地方性和特色的一些文化。
That's also the challenge for the scholars and the government in local Shanghai. They all try to do a lot of researches to try to figure out what's the local Shanghai features, what's the traditional Shanghai culture.
在这些方面，上海近几年做了很多很多的事情。这个如果做的话，还可以讲一个专题，就是政府做了很多很多的努力，特别是对我们的非物质文化遗产的保护下了非常大的力气。
Actually, the government did a lot with this topic. That's actually what's, if you go to Shanghai, that's always the top
government is concerned, they ask about, especially they spend a lot of money on the heritage culture of the Shanghai. Yeah, that's
也就是说，还有一点，我希望大家能够注意，就是。 上海目前的它的社区文化也是非常的发达，而这个社区文化的它的聚焦点其实就是作为这个城市的历史的它的文化遗产的这个。What
is published in Shanghai is government set up a lot of community centers in Shanghai, and the local community people they actually gathering to the community center all the time have. Their own like a cultural event all the time.
嗯，这个问题就这样解。
That's what the government trying to do for a long time. Yeah, that's also bothering them.
谢谢。
Actually, I just as a footnote to what you just said, I think it was a long time speaking of the cultural heritage in Shanghai. It was a long time in the 1920s. There was a very vibrant tea house culture. Right? Mm-hmm. People, you know, the Chinese patrons would go to tea house to enjoy local operas. Right? Yes. And the tea house actually were more popular and more expensive than the Western cinemas. Right? Mm-hmm. And you know, the opera houses were fancier. So that's just a footnote to think about how you could actually, looking back and perhaps you know, explore some of these old heritage. Mm-hmm. The other thing is, you know, I know that in your concluding paragraph, you talked about two obstacles, right? So one is the investment. The government hasn't invested enough in you know, local culture. The other one is diversity. So how do you, what do you see as the strategy to really you know, talk about bringing investment. And what do you mean by investment? Clearly, Shanghai does not a lack of construction. There's a construction boom, just continuous construction boom, right? You have training center, you have this and that, but these are the hardwares. So what is the software that really bring in the creative energy, right? So this is one. The other one is, you know, what do we mean by culture diversity? How do we cultivate creativity and diversity?
他刚才先是朱朱讲了，你刚才讲一讲，就是他就说，像1920年时代的中上海的那个茶文化，茶馆文化什么的，那个时候人们就会去茶馆文化里去听本地的戏曲和什么，那个时候可能比看戏还更贵和更有一些身份档次。然后他接着他提的问题是在我们最后一段里的两个问题，一个是。 你说的那个，其实上海政府的投资不够，但是从他看来，其实像这种什么东方梦工厂啊这些大量的东西已经都进来了，所以你指的这个投资是哪方面？是就是他看来硬件的投资是很多的，是不是你在软件上的真正软件内涵上投资有哪些？然后第二个问题是，关于文化的多样性这方面想一想。
我说的这个政府投资其实更主要的还是软件的投资，就是比如各种各样的基金。 对于这个支持文化的一些免税政策等等，这些我们这边还是很少的。
To answer your first question, the investment, the lack of investment, we're talking about, of course, the software investment. When we compare Shanghai with New York and other cities, it's we lack of the cultural foundations. The foundation mainly support the arts, and on the legal system, we lack of the tax deductions. Incentives for people to
比如说，我举一个简单的例子，比如说在上海，我们上海一个大剧院，大家知道是上海最有标志性的，也是最好的一个，最能代表上海的一个国家级的剧院。但是这个剧院，我们每年政府只给1000万。
等一下。
但而且，但是相比较而言，像柏林这样一个同等级的剧院，它一年应该是3亿，3亿人民币。
For instance, the biggest and the most distinguished cultural centers in Shanghai is called Shanghai Theatre. And this theater is actually supported by the Shanghai government. But guess how much money the government supports to this theater is only $5 million. But compared to the Grand Theater in Berlin, I think it's at least 10 times the government support is 10 times.
我再举一个例子，比如，我们每年10月份到11月份举行的中国 上海国际艺术节，这个国际艺术节，可能在座诸位都知道，它是中国目前可以说是最综合的，也是最大、最有影响力的一个国际艺术节。这样的一个艺术节，我们政府每年给的经费是，也就2000多万人民币。但是我们知道爱丁堡艺术节的投入是多大，政府的投入那不是这不是我们这个，可能是我们的100倍。因为有一前年我们。
Another example is the Shanghai International Festival. This is the most famous one in China, and the government support to the international festival actually is only 3 million. It's around 3 million, but 3 years ago, we invited the artistic director from the Edinburgh International Festival. The government support figure, what we heard is like around 100 times that what we got from the Shanghai. So from this point of view, our government is not that generous and rich than we imagined.
最重要的表现就是在文化和教育这部分投资还是很多。
If you're looking through how they invest in culture and arts, the percentage compared to the other parts of the government investment is really low.
Could you say something about variation across art form? It seems mainly you're talking about theater, which makes sense. But there's also the question of visual art and music, and both for the venues and the tickets, there's a lot of variation. And there's the consumption side, but there's also the production side. So I actually would be interested in how you compare production of art with consumption of art in Shanghai, and also within these three genres, let's say, visual art, theater, and music.
Mm-hmm.
Because my sense is it's quite
他想让你对比一下，因为你刚才讲了一些剧院的情况，他想让你从别的艺术形式来说，就是那个视觉艺术，然后音乐、舞蹈这方面，他想让你对比一下这个咱们制作的情况和，因为我们谈了很多就是票房啊这种，然后制作和票房的情况。制作和输出。就是我们的原创这些情况，对吧？应当说目前在。 因为视觉艺术，我也不做，但是这个表演艺术我还是相对比较了解。就目前来说，我们上海每年，我刚才有一个数字，这个数字是比较权威的数字，每年的表演艺术大概是在上海是18000场，那这个数字应当说还是比较少的，如果比纽约、比伦敦呢差别还是非常大。这里面的原创其实。 占的比例并不是很大，我们一个最大的差距就是驻场的演出是比较少的，就是驻场就长期一个演出可以演3个月或者演3年甚至更多时间，是这个基本上是非常少的，所以呢，我们自己上海我们自己也知道，我们在原创方面，或者在这个表演艺术的管理、经营运作方面，我们还是有很大的距离。
Professor Huang is not very familiar with the visual arts aspect, so his expertise is on the performing arts. In his article, we actually mentioned some number, like last year, Shanghai's total performance is 18,000 performance. That's deducted by the government, so that's the latest figures. But among these performances, it's very few amount of original plays. It's almost all from Western or imported plays. And the other situation in Shanghai is, it's not like on Broadway. You see, on Broadway, one show can be present at least over 3 months or something. But in Shanghai, we lack of this system. Something is only like present for instance, even for the big musical production, Lion King, they came to China, it's only three months. But generally, it's only like 2-3 nights or a week.
Was it because of the lack of audiences? Or lack of why?
驻场演出，上海的驻场演出， 比如有一个例子，我们现在运作一个上海一个比较有名的驻场演出，就是上海的那个马戏城的时空之旅。这个电影国外的游客吸引力非常大，它一年呢，今年是第十年，就连续演了第十年。但是我们知道这个制作它是加拿大太阳马戏的团队参与的，而且它还有国内最大的旅行社跟它合作。
It's maybe because the performance itself, the features, it's not that creative and smart or interesting enough to draw that much of attention, but we're not talking about Shanghai lack of audiences. This is one example. Professor Nolan, when she went to the Shanghai, we took you to the see a big show, a big circus show. This is already been performed for 10 years. But it's produced and helped us to make it by the Cirque du Soleil, that group from Canada. So that show has been exist for a long time, and they also have a very smart marketing system. So they did it with the major like Booking.com or Expedia.com, this travel agency. So they make it very successfully.
Can you go back to the diversity question? 所以我现在我就认为上海现在它是分两个方面，就是市场化的一些文化，就是商业性的文化，它基本上是就是西化的程度或者国际化的程度更高一些，但是政府对于公共，我们叫公共文化，就是公共文化或者是社区文化，它对多样性、对地方性注意的就更多，但是呢，因为市场化的这个文化，商业化的文化，它的影响力大。 所以我们往往呢看到的更多的是全球化的一些东西，商业化的东西，而在民间的这些多样化的东西，我们有时候呢可能看的不是太多。其实上海这方面也是非常丰富的，但是呢它需要提高。
For instance, in Shanghai's culture market, we divided to for profit or non-profit. The for-profit world, because they have to focus on the take sales, so this is more like a it's lack of the diversity. They all import like a big production from the overseas, the famous ones are easy to sell in the market. But actually in the non-profit, what we call in China called public art section and the community art, it's very diversified and very interesting. But nobody pay attention and draw attention to that sector.
Can you describe public art, what that is?
When
you say public art, you're saying it's like not-for-profit. 就是我们用事业、文化事业和企业，就是如果你是企业，那你就完全市场化，就像美国的这个非盈利性的企业。如果你是公共文化事业，基本上都是政府来投入来支持的。但是我们现在有很多问题，就是说，你是一个企业，比如我刚才讲的上海话剧艺术中心。 就是上海的一个国家级的一个话剧团体，它就是企业，它已经转制成了一个企业。
This is a very tricky question because it's not exactly like the for-profit world and non-profit world in the States. Because China tried to set up the divide line between those two types of, one we call the public art. It's actually, when you, it's a public art institution, you actually get big funding. It's easier to apply funding from the government. Then your mission should be to educate the audience and to bring the art to more people. That's their purpose. But the second sector the government wants to set up is some enterprise. You just do for-profit to commercial performances. That's your mission. But it's not deep that well in China, actually. For instance, there's a biggest dramatic art center in Shanghai. Several years ago, they become enterprise already. Their system should be an enterprise, so they should be for-profit. But they still managed to get a huge government subsidies, and a lot of their project got a lot of public funding. So this is a very tricky situation right now in China.
I have another question. Should I?
Yeah, Chinese.
let me do English first, and then I'll ask Chinese.
Great.
So based on our conversation and a lot of the questions asked, I feel that a lot of how the government measures culture is in terms of, and the success of culture is in terms of commercial routes, which mainly is money. And subsidies and all that stuff go into kind of a number figure. My question is, do you think that is an effective incentive to create culture? Because culture is something that is difficult to monetize. And what makes culture great is not necessarily its monetary value. And that may be a driving reason for kind of the lack of innovation and originality if you have subsidies and you lack of incentives. 所以我回到问题就是说我们今天就是说这个对话这个问题解答的这个过程当中我感觉我意识到就是很多时候我们讨论就是说在上海或者在国家的这个文化当中我们经常提到就是说 就数目就是钱的数目，就是说国家给就是地方或者国家给企业什么样的补贴，我觉得可能在某种方面这种补贴或者这个钱的这个估算，就是用钱来去衡量文化的发展，是一个不恰当的一个 metric， 因为这样会使就是很多时候艺术是无法用比如说金钱去衡量的。
那么是不是因为这方面的就是说incentives出现问题，这种刺激出现的太多，所以导致我们的文化就比较追求这个票房。对，这个如果从这个这个问题是个非常复杂的问题。如果从西方的这个哲学这个角度来看，那个艺术它肯定是非功利的，最好是跟利益有关系。但是我觉得 在目前这个状态下，对有些个人性的、创造性的艺术活动，它可能可以跟金钱、跟物质关系小一点，但是对于一些复杂性的、集团性的、需要大规模协作性、协作的这些艺术活动，它是没有办法就是脱离开这个物质的一个支持，像表演艺术，或者是大型的表演艺术。 它一定是大制作，它如果脱离了政府或者资金的一定的资金支持，它往往就没有办法。尤其是目前，特别表演艺术和科技结合，这个它更需要更多的一个资金支持。所以，我觉得特别在表演艺术方面，它能衡量出一个政府它对艺术的重视程度。
For a question, yeah, we shouldn't pursue arts on the monetary standard as the outcome. But however, like big productions, like what we see on Broadway, especially for big corporations productions, and now we're talking about a lot of new technologies coming on the stage design, even on the outcome of the arts. So we do need the government support or the other corporations support on the production cost.
cultural art partakers. And the second question is, could you elaborate more about the community center? What's its function of how it's operated? And because you mentioned there's hundreds of the community center in Shanghai right now.
我第一个问题啊，先生，第二，第二个就是他说了很多那个，就是你提到一个一百零三个那个社区文化中心，啊，it's not 100，two thousand，two hundred，两两百零三个那个文化中心，他就想让你对这个文化中心这个功能呀，或者这个怎么建立的这个机制讲讲。这个可以，我可以顺便给大家补充一点，就是在上海，我就是像上海这样一个，它属于一个省级的一个城市。 那么它的公共文化，它是市一级的这个文化机构和文化设施，像上海大剧院、上海图书馆、上海博物馆、上海美术、美术这些系列，我刚才介绍的都是市一级的这些设施和机构。那么它然后每一个区，它仍然有图书馆、有文化馆，它有一些剧场等等，区一级的。 然后我说的这个社区文化中心就属于第三级，它是建在街道或者镇，就是跟我们它是跟我们的行政机构是一致的，所以这一级的社区活动文化中心，它政府的投入是最大的，就政府的重视程度也是最大，也就是说它能覆盖最广大的这个市里，也就是说大部分。 90%以上的市民，他的文化活动可能更多的是通过这个社区文化中心，他来得到保证。
Let me answer the second question first about the community center. In Shanghai, there's a three level how the government involvement and involving art. The first level is the city level. That's the institution like Shanghai Grand Theater, Shanghai Dramatic Art Center. That's the first level. And the second level is belongs to the each district, like Hongkou district, Jing'an district. So they have their districts come to investment on their local institution and arts organizations. And about the community center, they actually belong to the lower level. It's their community government, they investment on them. But actually that investment is the most generous investment because a local place, they really care about what the people, the ordinary people, what they do, how can them can enhance their life standing. So that's actually the biggest investment on the community.
上海，因上海。那个这个社区活动，社区文化活动中心现在也是国家，就是我们国家，就中国政府也最关心的一个公共文化建设的一个焦点。但是它现在出现了很多问题，比如我举个简单的问题，因为它现在是按照行政机构来布局的，比如一个街道或者一个镇一定要一家。但是呢，我们行政机构呢，它往往是，比如有的街道它只有3万人。 但有的街道可能有三十万人，但它也只有一个，所以现在呢，政府就在解决这些不均衡的问题。从今年开始，可能投入更大，就是对这个社区文化活动中心。
To elaborate about the community center, the central government actually pay a lot of attention on this, but there's some not evenly display the money because this. The community center is based on the postcode number for this district. So some area has 10,000 people living in that postcode number, but some areas only 1,000. But they kind of divide the money evenly. So now that's what we have to figure out, how to best distribute the investment on the community center.
那么以前呢，我们对这个社区中心基本上都是就是政府完全来做，就政府投资，政府在管理。 政府在检查，在监督，现在也开始要求社会化，就是让一些非盈利机构来运作，来进行服务。
Right now, the community center actually invested by government and governing by the government. But right now, in Shanghai, it started to open to the non-profit organization or institution, try to let them to manage and governing the.
I have several remarks.
Yes, sorry.
Speaking of marketing, how to cultivate the consumptions of the cultural art market, and what's your speculation on the change of the trend of the consumption in this market.
这个问题也比较大，所以不是大。我可以举个简单的例子，比如说，我们知道上海它是在中国是一个电影的发源地，应当说在80年代以前，应当说上海的电影基本上就是中国的电影，但是呢，在80年代以后，上海的电影就开始。 就衰落了这个产业，但是我们上海最近几年就出台了非常大的一个政策，就是对上海电影产业振兴怎么样振兴上海电影产业，就这里面有一非常一系列的文件非常多，然后从教育电影的教育，到上海国际电影节，以及各种产业的扶持政策，在。 在整个国家应当说最有力度的，那么，到现在为止有了2年，但是这个效果已经非常好了。现在国内的基本上很多大的电影企业都集聚到上海。About
how to cultivate the market, Professor Huang gave an example about the film industry. Actually, probably a lot of you people heard about the China's film founded in Shanghai. Before the 1980s, basically all the major movie is produced in Shanghai, not in Beijing, before the 1980s, but after it started to decline. That's when the government got really nervous. They tried to revitalize the Shanghai film industry, and start 2 years ago, they have tons of policies and papers about the new laws and regulations, how to boom the Shanghai local film industry. For something like what I heard is like some film company, if they founded in Shanghai, you got tax deductible. And if you produce some film, the content relate to Shanghai or have some Shanghai features, you got a lot of subsidized. So it's been done for 2 years, tons of policies and regulations. So that's what government do. Like,
他们的电影很快就会出来。And
this area, if you've been to Shanghai, why they call the Oriental DreamWorks? Because the DreamWorks, the big studio from Hollywood, the DreamWorks, they've been set up in there already.
Again, it's film though, very quickly. When I know that Shanghai is establishing a Shanghai Film Academy.
Shanghai Film Academy.
Shanghai Film Academy.
上海电影大学，上海电影学院，它是说上海电影学院，就是现在上海是跟目前是跟就是政府就是和上海大学，就是上海大学引进了温哥华电影学院，就成立了个上海温哥华电影学院，但是很快马上上海就成立一个自己的上海电影学院，就上海市政府还是？就上海电影学院。
To elaborate that, actually, probably you heard about the Shanghai University have the joint new program with the Vancouver Film Academy. So this school already been opening in Shanghai since last year, but they're doing the non-degree trainings. But the Shanghai government right now trying to set up their own academy called Shanghai.
It's under Shanghai University, or it's a collaboration with
Shanghai University. It's
kind of independent from.
包括它是一个电影学院，一个美术学院，就都是在上海大学原来的二级学院基础之上成立一个一级的学院，就说它可能还让上海大学在管理，但是呢，它可能是相对有独立。
Oh, that's crazy. They actually built two academies. One is the Shanghai Film Academy. The other one is the
Shanghai视觉什么？那是上海视觉艺术学院。刚才说电影，一个电影学院。一个美术学院。
One is called Shanghai Film Academy. The other one is Shanghai Painting Academy.
Fine Arts Academy.
So this is actually it's founded by the two departments from the Shanghai University. So, but they built this to a kind of independent new universities, but still governed by the Shanghai University.
Very quick question. I feel like all my questions tend to be long. This question is very short. So, I feel like a lot of focus on culture and arts is government driven in China, especially in Shanghai. And there are kind of, there's a movement that you described that people are going to, there's a new space for NGOs to move into. Is there a space for kind of Western, more Western organizations to move into? 老师您刚才说的就是说很多时候就是说这个文化推动是由政府来主持的然后有在这个镇慢慢会由NGOs去主持那你觉得以后有没有就是说外企会参与这个或者合资的企业去
参与这个就是文化的推动在上海，至少在上海。事实上现在文化方面的一个政策，对于私人的企业和外资，一听就是应当说是非常的。比如举一个例子，就是比如电视、电影这个制作，私人企业是完全可以的。但外资呢还是有些限制。 就是说你比如说你不能供，你可以参加，但是不能供。但是呢，上海自贸区会出台这样的政策，上海的自贸区会出台这样的政策。应当说现在限制越来越少，应当说我说像梦工厂，像上海这个和梦工厂的合作，上海和迪士尼的合作，它就很难说这个这些合作市场已经打破了这个政策限制。
About the joint venture from overseas, now we can see a lot of film and television program actually produced by the joint venture. It actually has some regulation says the Chinese part of the investment has to be the dominant. But a case like DreamWorks and the Disney, there are actually different cases negotiated with the government. So it's in Shanghai, it's more and more open up.
I think this will be our last question because we're just about out of time. But I just wondered whether or not we've read about the founder of Alibaba who is sort of challenging individuals in China to put their money in the form of contributions or investments. And I'm wondering whether or not you think that portends for greater engagement
by philanthropists in China. Professor Huang, think no matter the public arts or for-profit arts development in China, it's actually right now it's not rational.
所以呢，像我们很多企业，特别是在产业文化产业上，它要做一点事情。但是呢，我们看，成功的也不多，成功的也不是很多，比较好的像万达集团的网页里做的相对好，但是很多企业做的其实很不好。所以马云做的怎么样，我觉得也可以看一看。
It's not the investment a lot from the private sectors, but this is not a rational money. A lot of big enterprise and rich people, they try to invest in arts. Those successful kids we can see right now is Wanda, a real estate development company. They build theaters and the entertainment, the big world, like Disney World, all over the country. That's a successful case. But about the Alibaba, the film investing firm, we have to see how it goes.
但是有一点，马云本身他就是中国现在最大的民营电影企业，就是华谊兄弟的，本身就是他的股东。
I don't know whether you heard about the Huayi Brother, it's a public trading film company in China. Actually, Ma Yun is a major shareholder of that company, so he invests all sorts of different channels to the film and arts industry.
Thank you very much. Have provided tea and snacks out there, so please help yourself.
Thank you.
I, that's what I'm saying.